Jonathan Ellis. I started DataStax about 8 years ago, based largely on the work that Avinash Lakshman did with his coworker Prashant Malik at Facebook. You open sourced Cassandra 10 years ago and contributed it to the Apache Foundation shortly after that.
Perfect.
We actually did meet at Johan Oskarsson's NoSQL Summit in 2009.
I remember now, I think you were sitting on the couch somewhere and maybe I walked
right.
in and that's how we got probably introduced.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the meeting was probably very brief.
It was. It was brief.
And after that, I think we have spoken quite a bit on chat and stuff, but I think face to face is
that's part of the power of open source, right? That
you can
do that without ever meeting.
Exactly.
So tell me how you got started in distributed systems, and I know you worked on Amazon's Dynamo before Cassandra. Was that kind of your diving in point, or was there
no? That was my diving in point. In fact, it all happened by accident. And the guys who were initially there, they used to sit in the neighboring cube, and I would hear them talk, and it all sounded very interesting, although I didn't understand a word of what they said. So I just thought, like, you know, why don't I take the risk, go talk to these guys and see if I can work with them.
Mm-hmm.
And everything came about that way. And they were gracious enough to give me the opportunity, and that's how everything started for me.
Cool.
And the friendships we forged since then, they hold up even today. In fact, I was just talking to one of these guys over Facebook. They're all remote, they're all over the place, but we talk almost every day. Either Facebook or chat or what have you.
The Amazon Mafia. Very cool.
The friendships really lasted. That's what I like about the whole experience.
Mm-hmm. One fun story that not many people know about is the time that I broke Facebook when I pushed some changes to the Cassandra project and you were running from the repository.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah.
I remember that. But, you know, at least the good news is the mantra at Facebook, perhaps even now, is move fast, break things. So breaking things and not held against you. So it's all good.
Nobody at Facebook is coming for my head.
No one is.
So as you worked on Dynamo, and then you went to Facebook, and Facebook said, we need something to do inbox search, something that's going to scale better than MySQL.
Actually, it was, again, by chance. When I was at Facebook, I worked closely with another buddy of mine, Prashant, a good friend of mine, and the way the whole thing came to be, Prashant used to smoke, so he was going down to take a smoke, and I was a new guy sitting right at the door, so he looked at me, and I'm like, yeah, why don't I join you? And not that I smoke, but I just went with him for company. Got to know him a little bit. He was telling me what he was trying to do, and I had actually started working on Cassandra just out of my own interest. Before even joining Facebook.
Oh, no kidding.
And I was talking to him, and I asked him, hey, would something like this be of any benefit to the problem you're trying to solve? Because he was trying to solve the inbox search problem. And that's how the whole thing triggered.
Mm.
And very good friendships forged. Anyone who works with me becomes a very good friend of mine. That's the way I always like it to be. So Prashant and I became thick as thieves ever since that relationship started.
Is he working with you at Hedvig?
No, he's in India right now.
Okay.
So,
we'll come back to Hedvig a bit later. But coming back to the early days of Cassandra, you were working on Jeff Hammerbacher's team for that.
Yes, so Jeff Hammerbacher was my first boss at Facebook. And when I initially started, he had a vision of bringing Hadoop in, and I remember having set up Hadoop and started trying some stuff, and then this whole opportunity to build out Cassandra for the search problem came to be, and he was extremely supportive of me doing that.
Jeff told me once that when you were building out Cassandra at first, that one of the first things you did was write the accrual failure detector.
Yeah, that was a very interesting project because Dynamo didn't have that. It had something based on a paper called, if I remember right, I think it was SWIM or something like that.
Mm.
But the accrual failure detector, someone brought it to my attention and they said it has much better properties, which you're obviously aware of. And so I thought that would be a good segue to start putting the building blocks together. And that's how the whole thing came to be.
So how much of there was it where you were looking at, you know, here's what we learned in Dynamo and here's the things that I want to improve on for this next system, or things like the failure detector and not doing vector clocks? Was that a kind of a conscious decision, or is it more of an experiment?
You know, so long ago, I don't even remember at this point, but the failure detector improvement obviously needed to be made. In fact, nobody knows this. I'm probably saying this for the first time, but the first cut of the Gossiper and the accrual failure detector that ultimately made it into Cassandra, I had implemented the whole thing in C++, and because I wanted to use it for some other project, and that's how the whole thing came to be. And the swim, we found a lot of downsides with the swim failure detector during the time. I can't recall now as to what exactly the problems were. And the accrual failure detector seemed to be a very good way of addressing some of those issues. And the vector clocks, you know, we did it for a reason. We had a lot of problems with it too, in terms of, you know, how you prune them and things like that. Mm-hmm. And taking this direction seemed to be a much better way of doing things, although not to say it doesn't have its own downsides, as you're aware of, but definitely, yes, it's definitely makes life much easier than dealing with vector clocks, for sure.
Yeah, if I look at the systems that came after Dynamo that were inspired by Dynamo, including the production DynamoDB at Amazon today, they've all looked at that and said, you know what, vector clocks is probably not the right solution in terms of the trade-offs of complexity with siblings and pruning and so forth.
Exactly, exactly. I think that's one of the to be candid, I guess I walked away from vector clocks more so because I didn't want to deal with the amount of thinking that I'll have to go through and fixing them at a later point. I just didn't want that headache.
Well, there's a headache both at the as an implementer, and then there's a different set of headaches as a user. And you know, we saw that with systems that implemented those, like Voldemort and and React both did a more of a straight up vector clock implementation.
I understand. I know this. Like the saying goes, there are two ways to solve a problem. Either you solve it the right way or you just eliminate the problem.
Yeah.
I chose the latter. That's easier to reason.
Yeah. So before we go farther, I think the question that everyone wants to know is, where's the name Cassandra come from?
You know, there was another buddy of mine who worked with us on Cassandra. He came up with the name because he said, this was apparently an internal code name for Oracle sometime way back in the past. And I think that's what he told me, and we felt like, hey, this could be a way to kill Oracle maybe, and so we came up with that name. It was his contribution, not mine.
That's pretty close to what I guessed. That's pretty cool, and we're starting to see that. I mean, we've put a dent in the Oracle site license agreements at a bunch of companies now.
I think that's fantastic, and I think all that credit should go to you, because I've not followed every little detail over the last 10 years, but to bring it to where it is now, I think you have a lot to do behind it, and that's phenomenal.
Oh, thank you.
No, absolutely.
Do you use Cassandra at Hedvig?
I don't. No, not really. What we had to build something that lent itself more to our kind of needs. Mm-hmm. The one thing that we absolutely needed was to build a distributed atomicity into that layer. Mm-hmm. So we built something that perhaps looks and feels like a Cassandra, but it's not the Cassandra version that's out there, because we needed to cater it primarily to our kind of needs.
That's probably a good place to talk a little bit about what you're doing now with Hedvig as a software-defined storage. Is that
absolutely
a good way to summarize?
Yes, perfectly. In fact, to describe Hedvig in a nutshell, what it is it's a distributed platform through which we expose a single abstraction we call a virtual disk, and applications have the freedom to, you know, embrace that virtual disk or program against it either as a block device or as a SAN or a NFS or SMB share, for lack of a better term, or you could consume the virtual disk as an S3 bucket. That's one aspect of what we do, and the other aspect of what we do is we take several what we call enterprise-grade features, things like compression, deduplication, replication, DR, encryption. We provide them as policies that you can turn on or off at a virtual disk granularity. So that's, in a nutshell, what Hedvig is all about. So if you peel the onion a little bit more, there's a clear demarcation between how data is laid out and how metadata for that data is laid out. And it's that metadata subsystem that kind of looks and feels like a Cassandra, but it has totally different semantics.
Okay. And you've been working on this for 5 or 6 years?
Well, 5 years now. Mm-hmm. 5 years now. And I think we are pretty close to shipping version 4 of the product. It's, in my mind, you know, I don't like to do the same thing over and over again. A lot of people think Dynamo and Cassandra are the same. I even stopped arguing with them. As you know, they're completely different systems. So I did Dynamo, and then next was to do Cassandra. And if you remember Dynamo, the storage subsystem was BuckleyDB. Mm-hmm. It also had some MySQL stuff, which we made pluggable at that time. But I wanted to build something from the ground up where you completely control the layout of the data, et cetera, et cetera. It has a lot of other benefits. Mm-hmm. And then after Cassandra, I felt like this could be the next big thing that I could go build. Mm-hmm. And it has a lot of ramifications in the enterprise, as you might be aware. But I like to do things different, and I like to keep pushing the boundaries of what I can go to.
Otherwise, it gets boring.
It does. I don't like to do the same thing again and again. I mean, the one thing that I'm very good at, what I have learned about myself over time, is the harder the problem, the better I am. The simplest of problems, I may actually just fail even attempting it.
Yeah, because you need to challenge yourself.
Exactly.
Are you CEO of Hedwig?
I am CEO of Hedwig.
So you've gone from the technical to the management path. Basically all at once, right? Or were you managing at Facebook later on?
No, I mean, at the time we were at Facebook, we were a team of two. I mean, Prashant manages me, I manage him. There was nothing more than that. This was a completely different kind of experience. I mean, we are not as big as DataStax. I think you probably have 500 to 1,000 employees, but we are still less than 100 employees, so it's still manageable. And I still have, I don't churn out as much software as I used to, but I still like to stay at the bottom of things.
Wow.
Just to keep a good understanding of where things are headed and how things are being put together.
So you still write code once in a while?
Actually, more than once in a while, but
wow.
But I don't do it as much as I used to.
That's completely understandable. I found about 3 years ago was probably the last time I wrote code for Cassandra, and I felt like if I took, you know, a couple days out of my week to really focus on the code, then I would cause negative productivity because of the questions that I wasn't answering and things people were waiting from me.
No, absolutely. In fact, I don't even know how you answered all those email questions that came when you were active on the mailing list on Apache, and that's something I could never do. It requires a totally different kind of, in my mind, a mental makeup.
Yeah.
And the ability to be able to do that patiently, keeping your calm, and also go and do what you need to do in order to push the product forward.
So I think one of the things that I see with individual contributors is they don't necessarily understand like the value of management and executives. So what do you understand now about what CEOs do and what management does that you didn't necessarily understand in earlier parts of your career?
Yeah, I still don't know if I do it. You know, it's kind of hard because I think the most difficult problem is people management, because it's kind of an unsolved problem. Mm-hmm. There is no real solution to it. People are different. You need to know how to keep your calm. When if the same situation were at home, I might have blown my top, you know. Mm. So figuring out how to get to people to get the best out of them, mm-hmm. and do it in a way where you keep them motivated, even though your heart's telling you that you need to put them in their place, that's the most difficult art I think one needs to figure out. I'm still working on it.
I feel like the 10 years ago when you open sourced Cassandra, and, you know, 8 years ago I started DataStax, open source and open core was a very good way to build an infrastructure company. And I know people who started database companies at around that time, a little bit earlier, a little bit later, without that open core. And it was just too difficult to get traction with enterprise customers. It's, you know, people would look at DataStax and say, well, you're a tiny company and you might not be here in a couple years, but worst case scenario, I can hire people to work on the code because it's open. So it gives people that security blanket. And I feel like that's becoming less relevant in the industry. And today, if I were to start DataStax today, I would go with an as-a-service approach. I don't think open source is as relevant in a cloud-centric world as it was 10 years ago. How do you see that playing out? And do you feel like it's a similar situation in the storage industry?
I think so too. I'm not sure about how the as a service would be applicable to someone like us.
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean it makes perfect sense in a database world? I'm not qualified enough to answer that. I haven't honestly thought about it. But I think when you look at, this is my opinion, mm-hmm. willing to stand corrected. If you look at open source and business, they're two different things, right? And the way I always tend to look at things from a business perspective is, let's take a look at how many companies went completely open source and have built a significant brand. If you talk to 100 people out there, 99 out of that 100 will say Red Hat.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's one company.
Right.
And also there was an excellent article written by someone from Andreessen Horowitz about open source and why. Look at these companies and look at the market cap that has grown over a period of time for the open source based companies, Red Hat included, and look at the other companies and see how much their market cap has increased by. And I thought it was a very good case in point, but I think the most important thing any business should strive on is what problem are you solving,
mm-hmm.
and how important is solving of that problem. Ultimately, those basics, I think, play out better. That's been my take thus far.
Yeah, because there's kind of a tragedy of the commons with open source, where, you know, I'm not necessarily motivated to pay for the development of that open source software because I'm trusting that you're going to pay for it. And if enough people reason that way, then nobody pays for it, and you know the development slows way down. And I think what's changed is that the cloud is shifting that needle. Where that balance is. And there's a lot of people like Amazon, for instance, is offering hosted Elasticsearch. Mm-hmm. To the best of my knowledge, they're not contributing significantly to Elasticsearch's open source project. They're just saying, hey, we'll make money off of this. And you know, that's totally reasonable and fine, but it does create this kind of vacuum of where does that progress come from?
The other problem that I have seen, and this might be more an artifact of the environment in which that system is running. For instance, the Elasticsearch example you gave, for someone like Amazon, I could easily envision something like they have a whole lot of other infrastructure in place for the way they publish metrics internally, and then you'll have to change code here and there to make sure that you spit things out in a particular format. Once you start integrating those little things in, it becomes a real pain to be able to contribute things back by extracting those things out.
Mm-hmm.
Then you don't even know whether what you're giving back is actually going to be a working piece of software.
Mm-hmm.
And that causes other problems downstream. And I guess that's one of the reasons why they take it and they figure that it gets too tied into their environment. It's hard for them to extricate that and put that out again.
Mm-hmm.
I think I can see that as being a significant factor in why many of these guys take some open source components and never contribute back. And that kind of makes sense, because in a large environment like an Amazon, or I'm assuming it's the same thing inside of Google, they have a lot of these tools and a lot of infrastructure for all this.
Right.
Which is very proprietary. And once you start tying into them, because you absolutely need to,
mm-hmm.
from an operational perspective, what have you, it becomes very hard for you to build a system that is going to be still going to use whatever was there in the open source.
Yeah, and I can look at it and say, I've got to solve this problem as quickly as possible. And if I go to the open source community and try to reason out, here's what I propose to do, and they say, well, that's not a general enough solution, you need to do it this way, you know, it can double or triple the time to do that. So a lot of the times I'm just going to say, you know what, forget it. I'm just going to do it the quick way that solves my problem, and I won't worry about contributing that.
No, exactly. And the other problem that I kind of foresee is, you know, when you cater to the enterprise, it's a very different mindset. If you take something from the open source, let's say there is an issue, your response can't be, I'm going to post the question on the mailing list and wait for a response. Right. I mean, you've got to fix the problem. Now it comes down to expertise. How much of that stack are you, you know, cognizant of for you to be able to go in and provide a fix at a rapid pace? I'm sure you're dealing with these kind of issues. But the good news is, a lot of the guys probably in here, you included, understand the soup to nuts at a high level. You don't have to know every line of code, but at least you know someone is there who can look at that. But some random guy in the open source is not going to be able to figure the whole thing out. Mm-hmm. And that's going to become a problem from an enterprise perspective, from a support perspective. And those are things that I think one should be very cognizant of. I would rather control everything than just control certain pieces and be completely oblivious about other aspects of the system and depend on some third party to provide an answer for me.
And that's why you should be a DataStax customer. Thank you.
Absolutely.